As the sun rises high and bright over the Zambezi River, so are the hopes and aspirations of the Watonga people. Hopes of a prosperous future, a future brightened by the abundant resources found in the vast water body and surrounding escarpments. The vast water body of the Zambezi is one of the largest man-made lakes or reservoirs in the world, and is known as Lake Kariba. It stretches from the vicious falls of Victoria Falls to the solid dam of the Kariba Dam. The lake is over 220 kilometers long, with a maximum width of 40 kilometers and 97 meters at its deepest point.
When it was constructed, it was the largest in terms of area and also in terms of volume, with an area of 5,508 square kilometers. It holds the volume of 180 cubic kilometers. In terms of volume, it still stands as the largest in the world.
The Zambezi is home to a variety of marine species. The lake is a border between Zimbabwe and Zambia, a border that divides a people, a border that divides kith and kin, and a border that divides the Watonga people in Zimbabwe and Zambia. To the Watonga, the river is not just another water body, nor is it just another source of livelihood. The Zambezi is a symbol of religion and belonging. The district of Binga is also known as Woman's Atontola, meaning the water with no impurities. The water with natural taste, the pure waters of the river Zambezi. The people of Binga are also known as Basirizi, meaning the people of a great river or a riverine people. The Watonga people have a district anthem that praises the Zambezi River. The district anthem is called Chigambio Chipati, which means a great wonder. The wonder of the Zambezi River. The district anthem is sung in schools and at official gatherings after the national anthem. In Binga, the Zambezi River is a great wonder endowed with many features of amusement, features for sustainable livelihoods, and features of religion.
Chigambio Chipati, what a great wonder! The Zambezi River. But the wonder of the Zambezi is not the water, but its people, the Watonga people. Let's find out more.
I'm proud to be Tonga. Yeah. I'm proud to be Tonga. Yeah. I'm proud to be Tonga. Yeah.
To the Watonga, the Zambezi is indeed a majestic wonder. The wonder of the Lake Kariba. But how was this wonder created?
In the years preceding 1957, the then government of the Nyasaland and Southern and Northern Rhodesia conceived a project to construct a dam, which we now call Kariba Dam. In essence, it's called Kariba Dam. And that dam was to displace quite a number of homesteads, which according to records totaled about 27,000 families relocated. The bulk of it, of those families went into the Zambian side, and quite also a substantial number were relocated into what we call Zimbabwe today.
This is the Zambezi Valley before the creation of the lake. the valley that will eventually be buried under volumes and volumes of water. Before the dam was built, the entire valley had to be prepared for what would become the largest man-made lake in the world. The colonial Rhodesian government used large earth-moving equipment to destroy the valley of its rich vegetation. The destruction was thorough and unrelenting. It was a case of you move or you perish. No compromise. Like these poor animals, the Watonga people had no choice but to be forced out of the valley, the only home they knew since time immemorial. The colonial Rhodesian government used traditional chiefs along the valley to address people, and the then paramount chief Binga also addressed people, explaining to them of the impending danger of floods and the need to move to higher ground.
Banonga babonganisigwa basimabhuku babusana nabo busena ibutekwa lokutekwa ngumkambe kuba lokusana nina na ambo kwa lokutekwa sikanyana bakalokuya bakasangona ebaphathi bahambilwa kuti omumumu kede mozolonzebwa ngambo kukaliba okuya uli mukujaliba ilwisi olundumu bene ibafuta lwisi olulwa janinwa.
But the villagers did not take kindly to what the traditional leaders were telling them. Some even thought their chiefs had lost their minds. No one was prepared to leave the ecological rich valley of the Zambezi. How could anyone possibly put a war on the mighty Zambezi? They asked. This is madness, they said. The Nyamnyam will not allow it, they charged. The Watonga refused to relocate upland. The displacement of the Watonga people tore their social fabric, with kith and kin being separated and chiefdoms disintegrating.
Some of the chiefdoms that were grossly affected by the relocation include Chief Simchembo, who was moved further into Midlands provinces, an area that we call Gokwe North today.
Why the Watonga Museum? This is where the history of our people and that of the Zambezi River is preserved. Let's get inside.
This map is very significant insofar as it captures the historical experiences of the Tonga people. Today, when people look at this map, generally they look at it as a map that shows the boundary between Zambia and Zimbabwe. But I think you would know that the Tonga people are found in the northwestern part of Zimbabwe. They are concentrated in that area where the Zambezi River runs through between Zambia and Zimbabwe. This area is also commonly referred to as the Gwembe Valley. It was a low-lying area, so it was popularly known as the Gwembe Valley. But it is the same area that we are talking about, which defines the Tonga people as a riverine people. They were popularly known as a riverine people because their life was centered, anchored on the Zambezi River. Today, the Tonga people are known as the people of the Great River or Rusilwezi, if you want, because of their interaction, because of their attachment to the river. It's called Zambezi today, but from the beginning of time, the Tonga people knew it as Kasambavezi. This is the name that they gave to this geographical landmark.
The name Zambezi is a distortion by the colonial settlers from the native name Kasambavezi. Initially, they called it Zambezi, but eventually they called it Zambezi.
The name itself that I've indicated earlier on, that it's Kasambavezi, it's also a warning, a strong warning to strangers that there is an opportunity to bathe, but beware, there are threats or predators in the river. So this sense of belonging is very strong. It's very strong to the extent that you cannot talk of Tonga identity without talking of the river. You cannot talk of the Zambezi River without talking of the Tonga people. That would be actually a technical abortion of the ethos and values of the Tonga people. So whenever you think of the Zambezi River, you cannot do so without thinking about the Tonga people. So the river, as it stands, it provided for the lives of the people in many ways. You talk of their spirituality. The shrines were also dotted.
Iti wandabi ya tu ingiro kutu wa ntubaye kubali kujigwela amalende ntumbazi ya malende. Jirangira mumani.
If you look right now, there are these dark brown circular dots. These indicate the old villages of the Tonga people. And you can see that it's a linear settlement pattern. That is, the river had strong influence on the lives of the Tonga people. So this is why you find the settlements run along the river, following the influence of the river. But then when the demo was created here at Kariba for the generation of hydroelectric power, it meant the water body enlarged backwards, thereby forcing the Tonga people to move away from close proximity of the river. And remember the attachment that I've just indicated. This was a horrible experience for the Tonga people, in the sense that you are now like being taken away from your mother, or being set further apart from your mother. This is why the Tonga always reminisce of life along the banks of the river. So the Tonga people always reminisce that after the resettlement, the forced resettlement, the Tonga people then were settled on these upland areas. And as you can see from the map, this green color illustrates the fertility of the land as we move from the river. And as we move away from the river, the fertility lessens. What is also interesting and striking in this is that before the creation of the lake, the Tongas managed to live in this area that was largely described by the whites as uninhabitable by human beings. But the Tongas have managed to tame this area, or to domesticate this area into a habitable land and a tourist destination today. So the Tonga people are very proud of their identity. They are very proud of their association with this river. It has become part of them. It is them.
The Batonga people were not just farmers on the river banks. They were and are still renowned fishermen.
This is the lecture side view. On this place, we are showing the different activities that the Tonga people engaged in. But at the same time, I want you to also take note of the creativity that the Tonga people engaged in as a result of this great river that we've talked about. We start by this dug-out canoe that was normally made from mukamba tree, right? So to facilitate movement and communication from one side of the river to the other. So this is the canoe that was normally used and is still being used by the Tonga people to cross from one side of the river to the other, to meet relatives, to pass on messages, and so on. We move on to this part where we have fishing traps. We have two different types of fishing traps. This one was used on a constricted area where it will be placed strategically, to the extent that when water flows inside, some of the fish will also get inside, but won't be able to come out of this fish trap. Move on to this one. It's called Zuo in Tonga. This one is
used for scooping fish from the river. Fish was rampant in the river. There was so much fish in the river that fishing was not even a prison for only men. It was for both men and women. So people would go to the river and scoop using this river. This was also a very handy fishing trap that was used by the poverty.
It was Balan Zila is landing and then Bubaralutequa. Baralutea Gabaleresia Imazuma. Ila Patti Ivanaras Baluveresia Mazuma. Ivalumi Baluveresia Imumba, we are Sila. Mumbandia Sile, Mumbandia Sile, Labia, we are Silavaita Branga. Babayabuya, Bau Jinko, we are Babuya Dabu, Babayabuya Sila. Babalonga Babaya Sabas.
We also have fishing spears. So this actually makes Tonga culture very unique. Not in any other culture do you find fishing spears. But here in Binga, you find the Tonga people have designed fishing spears.
Chimichi Nivalubereska in Sompo. In Sompo, Yavariavoti, Chop, Yavita, Yavaru, Chivo to Ann, Queen Lansaria, Yagalabranda, Wesson, Bupat, Ujuro, Yagalangi. This is what I will send a paradunjila doa. Wamucha musi munsompo omuya walongo anjisikabubo wagwisha musi kuhonda bamwe baba alikukita nibabika musa mtangwa nibaswabia walonga waita vene bakolwa wasangula kuhibu kama limboti bukalu 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 mbeza nibaswabia.
Besides the traditional methods of fishing, some Batunga used unconventional methods.
Baganonga babeleka basando bulo Basi kata angga kuari kembali masih kuari kembali bagian sila boleh kan sesiap sendera bawa orang tu boleh kukuh. Dulu ni dia ni dulu ke sesi ni ni angai mama kata ni esian tu sih usah jadi jangan sesiap boleh angga cincin angai mama mas. Iyo dia dulu kan yang sih usah dapat. Patolah ibato. Mas zamba ma parti malam pasang di mana aku dia. Lebih bulan sesi.
We are at Siampinza Munsaga's homestead, one of our elders who are displaced from the Zambezi Valley. Let's go and see him.
After the building of the Lake Kariba, most people were displaced and settled in the arid uplands. Siampinza Munsaga and his family were among such people.
I got to touch.
But how was life for the Batunga people on the banks of the Zambezi River?
Wakati kuli mwa incherera, baruti incherera, tega wakalinda wape kutita kuwemvula. Kambo, Luis mpu wali kugeda, wakabea buganka mwuzalisi.
Mr. Siampinza Munsaga and the rest of the Batunga people were very reluctant to move to arid uplands. Besides the issue of lost benefits to the Batunga community, another sticky issue was that of compensation.
The documented information tells us that there was no meaningful compensation. People were rather treated as relief recipients. They were given some bags of maize, of corn, as a means of gap filling before they harvested in their new areas. They also got a little bit of pounds by then, which was really insignificant.
For Mr. Siampinza Munsaga and the rest of the Batunga people, life on the riverbanks was so good, it is very difficult for them to remember anything bad.
Ibubi wakali kujanika chindecho, unze wakuti na kututavieni, ibubi wakali kujanika chindecho. te bwingi pe ibyo kugunywa amazi akuguteka kwali basitare mu Rwizi Guguluma bantu bamwe bantu bali kunga basimbe bya kuteka amazi walo mwa sitare
bari bubini niwa bari interese runga mabona ngabukijwa muri yo gutobo busika zigira ku ruma bantu tayo tujya bari bukazira.
But when the Batonga people relocated upland, they found real problems. There was no water.
Wakati di weni wakati kulongeza kwa bantu bantu wakati aingo tu tolo utawe manzi pe. Poe wakati manzi alamu tobe.
Ambolo kufuva zivuva zianda manzi. Zirimwa zianda manzi. Bagati zio yezes yekusia zibolani. Nige no ni kangala ta wet manzi na chani kama tulo kope bachi zio zame kuchita zidamu damu bagali kusia zilamga lamga imbobo ta zimani zikimunya kape.
But is it still all doom and gloom for the Batonga people?
Ubu umibwe sumbutu wakali tuwa zibira kogia wakali gubotu ibi yonta kutia ababasi kutu kisi kogia oguno baka zio tubikira zigolo matubikira migwagwa wenda muota.
By then, there was no secondary school, but now we do have a secondary school. And of course, there's an advantage that we have been connected to the rest of the nation.
As we move forward, now the big question is, what can be done to create a brighter future?
Sometimes when you go around, the old women, they will tell you, can you take us back to the rivers? But you can see the creation of the lake, where are they going to stay?
I told you, I'm going to go to the impact of the irrigation impact. Itape kutibantu batano kufika banza lumbe kupe gwabi ya nkogo balo kufozia sumu la wanda afanso ni batika tulimuru zitesi ya gali mope ambo bantuba gali gulima kufumbra jini.
The best approach is to ensure that people have got fair access to the resources that we call Lake Kariba. And when we say fair access, we're not just talking about the biological aqualife that abounds in the lake. We are talking about also access in the lake in terms of getting water for irrigation, in terms of ecotourism, the communities that suffered the biggest brunt in terms of that relocation should be given preferential treatment in terms of access to all those things. So probably what the government could do is to work with the local leadership to try and cultivate this idea, this feeling of ownership, to ensure that the descendants of the people who suffered that loss can invest and be supported to invest in an affirmative way, the way we did to the land issue in Zimbabwe. Because the land for the Tonga is the Lake Kariba that we talk about today.
So, Jin Tuji Patiment, I'll tell you. Hatu upege inguzo mbulimu tukale kede gale manza mwajina utibantu balabala iti.
We're back where we started, at the Zambezi River. Join us in the next episode as we continue with the story of the Zambezi River. I am Eldrina Mdenda. Twalumba.